the war against the greens, next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman. With me is David Helvarg, who has written an extremely important book about a battle being waged today against the environmental movement in the United States. The book is called The War Against the Greens. And David, what caused you to write this book? I mean, this took a lot of research.
Yeah, it was an interesting evolution, actually. I'd done a television documentary for PBS called Who Bombed Judy Barry about the Earth First activist in California who was a victim of a car bomb attack. And out of that, when I was working on that, discovered in the course of it a fairly organized and militant counter movement developing, pro-industry forces mobilizing against the environmental movement. And that was sort of where my interest developed back in 91. I was later approached to kind of look at this backlash nationally. As I said, during this conflict when Judy Barry, this activist, was bombed, she had organized what they called Redwood Summer, a protest against clear-cut logging of redwoods in Northern California, went to a cover demonstration in Fort Bragg, California, and there were about 2,500 environmental demonstrators. There were also about 1,500 what they called yellow ribbon pro-logging demonstrators. Very tense scene. They had like 450 riot police in full gear separating the crowds. There are a couple of hundred guys, as they used to say in Ireland, well into their cups, who showed up from the counter demonstration, threatened some violence, there were some arrests, a lot of tension. It kind of reminded me of marching days in Northern Ireland when I used to cover the conflict there. And seeing the emergence of that kind of polarization and crowd force on the side of industry kind of intrigued me. So when I had the chance to write this book, to travel around the nation and investigate what was behind it, it was a great just journalistic opportunity. And satisfied an interest.
Let's start, if we could, with the Judy Barry case. You spend about 10 pages in the book, 10 fascinating pages describing what occurred and how the government dealt with the situation. I mean, here she and a colleague were driving in a vehicle, and suddenly it blew apart. And I mean, she is still incapacitated. She's still disabled as a result of what occurred. The FBI, you write, charges Judy Barry with somehow having an involvement in putting a bomb. I mean,
right on this one, it's unbelievable. FBI failed forensics 101, which says when you have a crime scene, you go there and you let the evidence guide your case theory. In this case, what they had was an Earth First or a bomb, and at the time they were doing a domestic terrorism investigation of Earth First. Whether Earth First's advocacy of vandalism justified that investigation's another question I go into in the book. Fact was that they didn't do basic forensics. They came in there with a case theory that if it's an Earth First or it must be her bomb. Problem was the evidence didn't conform to this clearly as the investigation went forward. And really at the scene of the crime, you could see all the force of the explosion was directly from beneath her. The bomb had been planted under the front seat of her car. As the investigation progressed, it became clear that it was a motion device that was designed to explode as she drove her vehicle. Once the evidence moved away from her, Judy Barry, once it was clear that she was the victim and not the perpetrator, the FBI seemed to lose interest in the case. They certainly didn't do as vigorous an investigation after the evidence steered in other directions. Unfortunately, it's something of a pattern I saw. In my book, I document 60 out of several hundred serious cases of violence against grassroots environmentalists that have taken place around the country over the last several years. And for the most part, law enforcement has not given fair and equal enforcement response. I think a lot of the violence has taken place in rural, low-income communities that are dependent on single industries, either polluting factories or resource industries in mining and timber, where the perspective of those who protest is that they're outside the realm of protection, certainly for, if not local law enforcement, at a federal level, the FBI failed to respond, failed to see And somebody with oversight for the FBI explained this to me. A congressional oversight person said that violence that's perceived in defense of the status quo somehow isn't seen as domestic terrorism, whereas violence, even if it targets property as against people, that's seen as attacks on the system, may get that definition. And the FBI tends to lead local law enforcement in defining what's terrorism. Unfortunately, we didn't see equal enforcement in the violence that was directed against grassroots environmentalists over the last 5 years. As a result, the people directing that violence expanded their target list. Now you see a lot of violence being directed against federal employees of resource agencies, of the Bureau of Land Management, of the Forest Service. Guy Pence is a Forest Service manager in Nevada. He's had both his office and his home bombed. His private van in front of his home was bombed 2 months ago.
This has become lethal, the story of Leroy Jackson, the Navajo activist. Perhaps you can relate that.
Yeah, Native American activist, 3 days, again, we don't know, but unfortunately, since the state of New Mexico police closed the investigation, we may never know if he was a victim of a homicide. Clearly, very suspicious circumstances. He was an anti-logging activist on the reservation. He received death threats from the logging industry there. 3 days before he was to fly to Washington to testify in front of the Bureau of Indian Affairs, he was found dead by the side of the road of a methadone overdose, a drug overdose. There was tobacco in the van. He didn't smoke. He didn't drink. His friends, even law enforcement, agree he never took any kind of drugs, and yet he died of a toxic reaction to methadone. So it was similar to the Karen Silkwood situation. The violence that's what's scary about the violence that's emerged in the last several years is its linkage with a larger political agenda that's being pushed by resource industries in the West, by various right-wing activists. I parallel the growth of this anti-environmental violence in the last 7 years with the growth of the wise use movement, so-called wise use movement, which some people have defined, and in part it is what the New York Times calls an astroturf movement, that is industry-created grassroots. In 1988, several hundred activists, veterans of the Reagan administration and the New Right, got together with representatives from the mining, beef, and timber industries in Reno, Nevada. They brought in some hunters out of touch with their sports conservation ethic, some ORV people who like to take their vehicles off-road into wilderness areas. And they wrote together what at the time was this very radical wise use agenda, 25-point program calling for opening up the national parks to resource development, opening up all wilderness areas to mining and grazing, selling off the public lands to the states and private industry. Quite radical in 1988. Today it's the much of the congressional agenda in the new House. What was interesting is when I talked to these people, I said, you know, why then? Why did you have to meet in 88? What they said is George Bush, we didn't trust him. These were the veterans of the James Watt era in Interior, of Ann Gorsuch era in EPA, the hardcore free marketeers who didn't believe in any form of environmental regulation, and they didn't trust George Bush. They thought he was too liberal. He was betraying the kind of hard right ethic. And these people have become a major political voice in the West when, as I say, when you see these physical attacks not only against grassroots environmental activists like you know, Paula Seemers in Cincinnati, or when you go further west and you see people like Judy Barry, or in Texas, a woman, Wilson, a shrimper, who was attacked. Very little response to it. Now you see, even with federal agents, I've talked to agents from the Bureau of Land Management, the Forest Service, who say they haven't gotten the response from Washington. And in part, it's because the violence has political backing. People, for an example, is Fish and Wildlife agents in Idaho went to investigate the shooting of a protected wolf. Local rancher threw rocks at them. Local sheriff came and threatened to call out the militia. The response by Larry Craig, the senator from Idaho, was to call for the disarming of the federal agents, of the Fish and Wildlife people. And so there's sort of this coming together, and we saw it with the militia. In the West, it really used wise use as its major recruiting ground. It's kind of a funnel effect. The big conspiracy in Western politics is what they call war on the West. The idea that somehow if you threaten their federal subsidies, you're denying the West its freedom. And within that, they talk about states' rights, because I think a lot of Americans don't have the historic memory to remember that states' rights was last used in the South to justify segregation. Today, Western states are using it to justify extractive industries operating on public lands. And you get from the War on the West conspiracy theory to states' rights to the counties movement, which is a part of wise use, argue essentially that the local sheriff has the right to arrest any federal land manager who fails to respect what they call their custom and culture of mining, grazing, and logging on public lands. And within the counties movement, the National Federal Lands Council, which is sort of the umbrella group for the counties movement, has put out cover stories advocating the formation of armed militias. And there has been violence. Dick Carver, who's a leader of this movement, ran a bulldozer into public lands to try and open up a road, ran it at some Forest Service agents who were trying to stop him. He was backed by an armed posse and later bragged to several right-wing symposiums where he's spoken about how if one of those rangers had gone for his gun, there were 50 people who would have drilled him with their handguns. And so there's this vigilante spirit that gets some political backing from some powerful industries. And I think now that it's come out explicitly in the form of the armed militia, the far right, a lot of industries are running the other way, trying to distance themselves. But at some level, when you have the American Mining Congress, the Farm Bureau Federation, the Cattlemen's Association, have spent years sharing wise use platforms with some serious fringe elements, with Moonies, LaRoucheites, John Birchers, county secessionists. And I think they shared these platforms, they gave them legitimacy. I went to these meetings where you heard this crazy conspiracy talk, the UN takeover of the West. These industries have some moral responsibility. It's almost a Frankenstein effect. You know, when industry tries to create its own grassroots, it doesn't necessarily retain control over them.
We'll be back right after this.
Since 1974, Plenty International has been a valuable tool for people who want to lend a hand, but in ways that are effective, respectful, and appropriate. Much needs to be done, like installing running water for Mayan villages in the highlands of Guatemala, helping Native Americans develop home gardens, and working for the improved nutrition of children in Nicaragua. Plenty fields volunteers from all walks of life and recognizes the interdependence of all living things and works to promote economic fair play, cultural diversity, and a livable environment. If we put our minds, hearts, and hands together, we can do what needs to be done. For more information, please write Plenty, P.O. Box 2306, Davis, California, 95617, or call 916-753-0731.
I dreamed all of the animals will be safe forever.
I dreamed our water got clean again.
I would like more trees to grow.
And the ozone layer will get strong again.
Fish are neat, and I don't want any of them to die.
I dreamed our Earth will get well again because everyone who lived here started doing things to help it.
Help our planet to get better.
Earth Day is April 22nd.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe. Trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen.
You are lucky.
Clean it up.
Nuclear waste. The problem is bigger than you think.
We're back with Enviro Close-Up and David Helvarg, author of The War Against the Greens, and a very important chapter in the book, David. It's titled Inside the Beltway, and you get into the Washington Times and the Heritage Foundation, and wow, there's a lot of anti-environmental action down in the District of Columbia area today. Heritage Foundation.
Yeah, founded by Joe Kors, at least he put up the money, and Paul Weyrich, who's a kind of creator of the New Right movement, essentially considered very fringe until Ronald Reagan came in 1980, started writing policy. I just came back from Washington. Today, Heritage is considered not quite there. It's the Cato Institute that's like more out there. They essentially argue what they call free market environmentalism, which means get rid of all laws and regulations and let the market determine how things go. It's very strange. I was talking to people inside the Beltway, the kind of new congressional majority. And, you know, what you really have, there are even some moderate Republicans who are beginning to see that they were not given a mandate to clear-cut 25 years of environmental protection. But those moderates do not control the party anymore. You have kind of between the Christian right and the anti-regulatory forces, what I call those who believe in the Father, the Son, and the invisible hand of the free market. They really don't believe in legislation that's worked, like the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act. They have, in lieu of popular support, and all the polls are showing 70 to 80% of the American public believe that these laws are working, support the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, the Endangered Species Act. About half the public believes that we need more stringent environmental regulation, not less. It's something that's making the Republican leadership nervous, but they're still pretty much enthralled to this radical deregulation element. And, you know, I spoke with Don Young last week, who's a congressman from Alaska, and he was going on about you and the media, how you're beating on the environment. I pointed out that the Anchorage Daily News was also criticizing him, and he explained that it was part of the McClatchy chain from California, and how McClatchy's just sending all these communists up to Alaska to go after him. And, you know, it's common rhetoric now that they attack the EPA and Bruce Babbitt, the Department of Interior, as Gestapo, as stormtroopers. I mean, this is what you're hearing. And I think part of it's this kind of feedback mechanism where, for example, with the Endangered Species Act, Don Young, who's now in charge of what used to be the Natural Resources Committee, he dropped the word natural when he took over last November, goes out and stages endangered species hearings in very chosen spots in rural parts of the West. The local Farm Bureau Federation, cattlemen, stack the meetings. And then he and his staff people come back to Washington and say, we've been out there and the American people are fed up with the, you know, radical solutions of the, what they either call watermelons, green on the outside, red on the inside, or else they refer to environmentalists as preservationists and pagans who worship trees and sacrifice people. I was surprised to find, bought a lot of their own rhetoric. And of course, there's also an element of cynicism, which is it's much easier when you're destroying 25 years of very popular environmental laws, or attempting to destroy them, to say that you're responding to some angry constituent backlash rather than admit you're responding to the agenda of your major PAC contributors in the American Mining Congress or what have you. And even there, I mean, another irony is out with the organizers on the ground, they're taking on this increasingly radical rhetoric of places like Catron County, New Mexico, and Whitefish, Montana, where the militias are organizing that environmental protection is part of the UN takeover plot. The irony is that a lot of the industries that are backing this, of course, are multinational. Over half the gold now being mined on public lands in the West is being mined by foreign companies. I mean, I went to visit one of these mines in Nevada, and I'm in the middle, I'm 400 feet down in this pit in a gold mine called the Independence Mine, in the middle of a national forest, and I asked the mine supervisor if Independence Mine's locally owned, and he hems and haws and kind of, you know, scratches the dirt with his boot and says, well, it used to be, but it's now owned by De Beers. So De Beers of South Africa, making about $180 million a year profit, paying no royalty to the taxpayer. This is the kind of outrageous laws that this movement is really there to protect.
And this is Wise Use. We'll be back with David Helfrich and War Against the Greens right after this.
I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
If you're not recycling, you're throwing it all away.
This year, the nuclear industry is spending millions to sell you on nuclear power. Let's look at the facts. Conservation and solar energy have saved consumers hard-earned dollars in homes and factories across the country and have put Americans back to work. Dollar for dollar, these investments make a lot more sense than nuclear power. And the benefits go directly to you, not the nuclear industry. Nuclear power creates waste. Conservation creates jobs.
The book is War Against the Greens by David Helvarg. David, you write about media. You write about media and how they deal with the environment from the Washington Times, one of the favorite papers during the Reagan era, to the New York Times. Give us the span of focus in terms of the environment from the Washington Times to the New York Times.
Well, I think I'd almost like to take it historically because it's interesting, which is the backlash got organized as wise use in 1988, but it was really 1990 that it got mainstreamed in the media. And if you remember, 1990 was the 20th anniversary of Earth Day. Millions of Americans participated. Time magazine had Planet of the Year cover. It was also the time that communism was collapsing in Eastern Europe, and which you'd think the new right would be celebrating in Washington. In fact, there's a lot of nervousness, especially among their fundraisers, about where to go next. And with millions of Americans out in the streets protesting on behalf of the environment, I think they saw an opportunity to at least try out the green menace, you know, to replace the red menace with the green menace. You look at the 1990 coverage in the conservative press of Earth Day, the National Review, Human Events, the Washington Times. They were all really talking about environmentalism as the next great threat to free enterprise. And because they're fairly extensive and well-funded, the conservative press has an ability to mainstream its message, and a lot of it did get into the mainstream media. We saw several years of these kind of apocryphal stories about overregulation and kangaroo rats causing people's homes to burn, and you know, there was too much regulation on endangered species and clean water and wetlands. I think essentially the backlash message got mainstreamed by a number of people. Keith Schneider's the former environmental reporter for the New York Times, who's moved on. He kind of legitimized what Rush Limbaugh and a lot of other folks were saying.
Well, what about the New York Times? I mean, it's one thing for a moon-owned newspaper like the Washington Times to jump on this far right-wing agenda and scream about environmentalists and so forth, but how did Keith Schneider become the environmental reporter at the New York Times?
Well, I think there was a change at an editorial level, and I have a chapter.
Good
briefly, Phil Shabakov, who was their former reporter, was replaced. At the editorial level, there was an editor who wanted to see more focus on the cost of regulation, and I think what happened in this one instance is that somehow the editorial desire spilled over onto the news pages, and you found a reporter who was very ambitious and who responded to an editorial mandate perhaps more than he should have as a journalist. What's kind of interesting is somebody who's been in television a number of years is that if I can say anything about the media, we're totally non-self-reflective. And so after years of kind of acting as a conveyor belt for all these backlash stories about kangaroo rats and spotted owls, we've suddenly discovered that they're getting rid of the Clean Water Act, and with the same kind of fervor, the media is beginning to say, well, why are they getting rid of something that works? I think that's a response to the polls and the larger majority of Americans who are beginning there was an assumption that things were going well. Now they realize they're not, and they're beginning to make themselves heard again. And I think that's, you know, my book's very, some people find it depressing or they say it's a very scary book. I think what's hopeful is that in looking at how this backlash is organized and how industry and the right came together, what I found is they never reached a critical mass in this country. That really what you have in the environmental backlash is thousands of people pretending to be millions of people. It's not the Christian right, it's not even the NRA. It represents a minority viewpoint, and the great majority of Americans believe in environmental protection. They believe that you know, it's very important to them and their kids that there be clean air and clean water and wilderness and a place to go to experience nature in its full variety. And I think that for all that the backlash threatens on a political and sometimes even a physical level, that the majority of Americans believe in environmental protection and will fight to keep it.
We'll be back with Enviro Close-Up right after this.
The safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us.
What can people do about this war against the Greens?
I think they can get re-involved. They can recognize that, you know, acting locally, they can have a tremendous effect nationally and internationally, and they should just hold the politicians' feet to the fire, not just Republicans, Democrats, anybody. This is going to be one of the hot issues in 96 and beyond, and I think that just, you know, getting out there and re-engaging, recreating community. Don't watch TV, you know, turn it off and go out and go door to door and talk to people, because the majority's already with you.
The book, War Against the Greens, by David Helvarg. Get it. Thanks for watching. This has been Carl Grossman.